And welcome to Begin in the Word. Today we continue our studies from the book of Haggai with a focus on learning from Haggai. What does Haggai's book teach us today that relates to our relationship with God and how we live our daily lives? Today we're going to talk about the desire of nations, part of the promise that's found in the book of Haggai. Let's begin with our review questions. What are two basic ideas regarding the desire of nations? Number two, what do the scriptures say creation desires most? Number three, what does it seem man desires most? With those questions in mind, let's turn to the text that's the subject of our study today. Haggai 2 and verse 7 says, "And I will shake all nations, and they shall come to the desire of all nations, and I will fill the temple with glory, says the Lord of hosts." Here the scriptures talks about the coming of the desire of all nations. Now you might recall from our previous study that we talked about the shaking of the nations and what that was about. This passage also talks to us a lot about the temple and this great glory of the temple. And those are all things that we'll discuss in the future. But for today's study, what is this desire of all nations? Observe that there's a lot of question as to exactly how this passage should be translated. An alternate way of translating this can be seen in the King James Version. "I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come." So in one way of translating it, they've got nations or people coming to the desire of nations. In the other one, they've got the desire of nations coming or arriving. And the difficulty of that translation has to do with the plurality and some complexities in the book of, or in the Hebrew language. And I'm not going to go into all that. I'm just going to leave it that there's some question about it. And so far as I can tell, the more common way of translating it is that the desire of all nations will come, that it's talking about the coming or the arrival of the desire of all nations. Some say the word translated desire there should be translated wealth. It's a term that can mean that, though it doesn't necessarily have to mean that. So some say this has to do with wealth coming to the temple. Let's look at these basic ideas regarding the desire of the nations. One of them says that it's about Christ, the desired Christ coming to the temple to fill the temple with glory, and the arrival of the Christ. In other words, this view would have Haggai encouraging the people of Judah, proceed with your temple work, keep doing what you're supposed to do and being what God has called you to be, and work patiently, and in time, your Savior will come, the Messiah, the Son of God. A very similar view, as it's translated in the New King James Version, has the nations coming to the desired Christ. And this view is very similar in that it still deals with the idea of Christ coming. It just switches the, in order to deal with some of the translation difficulties, it switches the phrase to have people coming to Christ. But in either case, it would be a word of encouragement to the people of Judah in Haggai's day to press forth in their relationship with God under the comfort of the promise that the Messiah would come. Another idea about this text, and a fairly common idea, is that the desire of all nations is wealth, and that would have the desired wealth of the nations. That is what everybody wants, wealth, and so that's what they desire, and that would be coming to the temple so that the Jews there could finish the temple. Well, this view is not without its difficulties, and I recognize the word translated desire can certainly carry the idea of wealth, but in Haggai's day, or even in the years that shortly followed, there wasn't another grand influx of wealth into Judea from all the different nations of the world. That just didn't happen. Many years later, Herod, under the Roman Empire, went in and embellished the temple as a special project and added to it a lot and spent a lot of money on it. Well, that wasn't the wealth of every nation. That was just the wealth of the Roman Empire being poured into that project. So there's really nothing future to the time of Haggai that seems to relate to a prophecy of just wealth from around the world coming to help finish the temple. You could certainly imagine how that would seem like a hopeful message to the people trying to build the temple, but it never happened. And whatever this message is about, it's about something that would relate a fulfilled promise, or a promise that would eventually be fulfilled, that would, in which they could fix their hopes. So let's go back and look at the text. I'll shake all the nations, and they shall come to the desire of all nations. Is the word desire there really about wealth? Is God focusing this promise on the idea of wealth coming? To me, that's an interesting question, because the very next verse deals with the question of wealth. He said, "The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, says the Lord of hosts." Well, the silver and the gold of all nations already belongs to the Lord. The Bible teaches the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He owns everything. All of creation is rightfully his possession. So why would he need the desire, that is, the wealth of nations to come enable him to do a work that he can already do because he already owns all of it? So that's another point that suggests, at least in my mind, that the word desire there is not pointing to wealth. And you may study that text and have a different idea, but that's the understanding that I have of the text. Let's look again at some other phraseology in this passage that relates to this desire of nations. He said that the desire of the nations will come. And then the Lord said, "I will fill this temple with glory." So this coming desire of nations is going to be connected with the idea of that temple that they were reconstructing being filled with glory. So here were the Jews working on this temple. And as we've talked about in previous studies, there were stages there where they felt disappointed what they were expecting the temple to be like versus the reality of what it was really like was a trouble of mind to them. And they were struggling with that. And so part of God's message of encouragement is, "I'm going to fill this temple with glory. I will do it. You don't have to worry about how fancy it looks. I will fill it with glory." Well, is the glory that God was going to fill that temple with wealth from other countries? Solomon had already built a temple like that. This was to be a glory that was going to be greater than what we saw in Solomon's temple. So it had to be something greater than wealth. And it's what the nations desire the most. Let's read about that. In the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 19 through 22, the Bible says, "The earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption to the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now." This passage depicts not just all of mankind, but the whole of creation having an earnest expectation, something that we're eagerly waiting for. It's something for which creation groans and labors. Well, what is that? Well, in the context, he's talking about release from this bondage of corruption. Because of sin, the world is a corrupt world. And this passage talks to us about how all of creation desires to be released from that corruption. So this takes up the theme that the idea of the desire of nations, or all nations, this what man universally wants, is freedom from the brokenness of this world. And many crave that, not even with a full spiritual realization that that is their desire. And Christ is the only thing that supplies all of that. He brings the promise of salvation from sin. He brings the promise of relief from death. He brings the promise of an eventual resurrection who will be raised, glorified, and immortal, and liberated. He uses the word liberty here in Romans chapter 8, liberated from the bondage of corruption. So in that sense, you can see why a person would say, wait a minute, what all nations really desire the most is what Christ supplies. Notice what he said about humans' desires in Psalms 27 and verse 4. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell on the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Here the psalmist talked about his one main desire in life, and that boils down to the simplicity of being with God, dwelling with the in the house of the Lord, and beholding God's beauty. That's what we really all want the most. When a person is facing a terminal disease, do they sit and think, well, I wished I had more money? When a person is facing the hour of death, their own death or the loss of a loved one, do they sit and think, well, if I just had more wealth, that would fix all this? When a person's heart is broken with guilt and regret over sin, do they sit and think, you know, if I had a deeper stack of $100 bills, that guilt would go away? I know that people desire wealth, but I believe that the Bible teaches what we most deeply desire is what Christ supplies in our relationship with God. And that is the promise in Haggai's day. Keep working. Keep doing what you're supposed to do. And someday God will send a Savior whose presence will beautify this temple. Now let's look at our review questions. What are two basic ideas regarding the desire of nations? The desire of nations is either Christ or wealth. That's the two more common ideas. What do the scriptures say creation desires most? Well, we found in the scriptures that creation desires release from the bondage of our sin-corrupted state. What does it seem man desires the most? Well, based on reading passages like we read in Psalms 27, it seems that man most desires closeness with God through escape from sin and death. All of these things Christ generously supplies in his perfect sacrifice. Think about in Haggai's day, them hoping for the coming of a Savior, and recognize that today our Savior has come. And just as they were to place their hopes in him, so should we place our hopes in Christ as our Savior, not in the feeble offerings of this life. Thank you so much for tuning in to our study. As we've begun today in the Word, we pray that you'll live out today and every day in the Word of God. Thank you, and God bless.